I will talk about something more or less directly related to our world today, to the Bolsheviks in isolation and self-isolation and individualism in the name of collectivism and in the lives of some of the world's most consistent collectivists. So let me show you some pictures. Let's see. I assume you can see, right? The
yes.
Picture. So before the revolution, the Bolsheviks were, I believe, a millenarian sect anticipating a bloody apocalypse, followed by a vaguely described state of perfect harmony. And you can see one of those sectarian meetings on your screens. Life on the ground, as they called it, was the usual sectarian combination of a more or less radical separation from the corrupt world and the intense camaraderie in a variety of communal settings. The ultimate site for both isolation and togetherness was, of course, the prison, where young revolutionaries spent much of their time in study and conversation. This is Lenin's prison photographs. The most extreme form of isolation was solitary confinement, a form of punishment imported into the Russian Empire as a concept and penitentiary practice from Britain and the United States in the middle of the 19th century. Socialists placed in individual cells described the experience as extremely depressing and combated loneliness by pacing, exercising, often following rigid regimens, making friends with rats and spiders, reciting poetry, tapping on walls using a special prison alphabet, and singing at the top of their voices, sometimes along with other prisoners, if they could hear each other through the walls. Some describe cathartic moments of brotherly love, as dozens of voices would form an invisible choir celebrating the coming revolution and subsequent eternal togetherness. And I will play just a little bit of the song they sang most often on those occasions. It's called Warszawianka. It's a Polish song translated into Russian. And so on. And there's the obvious crescendo, and the volume rises along with the singer's enthusiasm. Let me see where my... this is Lenin in his prison cell. Most prisons allowed reading and writing, and that's what most inmates did, using prison libraries or books brought by their comrades from the outside. They read political economy and revolutionary literature and studied foreign languages, but even the toughest revolutionaries admitted that the most effective way to combat loneliness was fiction. Mostly Pushkin, Gogol, Tolstoy, Dickens, Balzac, Heine, Ibsen, and Hamsun, among others. Another form of state-imposed isolation was Siberian exile, which combined confinement and sectarian solidarity to a much more concentrated degree because it was both a form of banishment and the chance to create a self-administered community of true believers, complete with courtship, marriage, and childbirth, indifferent that way from monasteries, which were their models. Some suffered from depression, especially during long Arctic nights, drank heavily and came close to losing their faith. Even Yakov Sverdlov, a revolutionary from Nizhny Novgorod, famous for his superhuman energy and irrepressible good humor, became desperate when he found himself in a tiny native settlement with only one other exile, a Georgian Bolshevik by the name of Iosif Djugashvili. You know, my dear, how horrible the conditions there were, he wrote to his wife after being transferred to a larger village. The comrade I was with turned out to be such a person socially that we didn't talk to or see each other. It was terrible. But such moments passed quickly, especially for Sverdlov. And most exiles spent most of their time reading, writing, hiking, hunting, debating, falling in love, and prophesying the coming of the apocalypse followed by the millennium. Or as Sverdlov put it in one of his letters to one of his female followers, the final act of human tragedy. The prophecy came true in February 1917. The unfriendly Georgian Bolshevik returned to Petrograd as Stalin, and Sverdlov became the all-powerful secretary of the Central Committee, the first head of the Soviet state, the face of the Red Terror, the organizer of the murder of the Tsar, and the inventor of the Bolshevik fashion for leather jackets. There he is. Obviously meant to symbolize toughness, firmness, and where needed, ruthlessness. In January 1919, he initiated the extermination campaign against the Don Cossacks. In March, he died of the Spanish flu. For the Bolshevik leaders, the revolution and civil war were a time of homelessness, sleeplessness, ceaseless motion, and enormous crowds. The most recognizable voice was that of Trotsky, who spoke to the masses and for the masses. Or rather, the masses spoke through him. Both isolation and self-isolation had been finally overcome. And I quote here, "I would make my way to the podium," he wrote, "through a narrow trench of human bodies, occasionally being lifted above them and carried along, surrounded on all sides by tightly squeezed elbows, chests, and heads. I seemed to be speaking out of a warm cave of human bodies. At certain moments, it almost seemed I could feel on my lips the eager intensity of the crowd that had melded together to become one." After the war, the surviving Bolshevik leaders, now top government officials, moved into the Kremlin and several downtown Moscow hotels that had been converted into dormitories known as houses of Soviets. And here are two of them. So the most important ones, this is the National Hotel in Moscow, which is still there, of course, known at the time as House of Soviets number one, Первый дом Советов, and the Metropole House of Soviets number two. They moved into those hotels, former hotels, and settled into a familiar, but also increasingly self-doubting and once again separate communal domesticity, bumping into each other on the stairs, visiting each other's rooms, smoking cheap tobacco, drinking strong tea, having lots of sex, arguing about historical necessity, running the world revolution, and wondering about what should come next. Where and how should communists live? What does communism mean in everyday life, both before and after communism's eventual arrival? There were two main schools of thought. The so-called urbanists envisioned large communal houses organized around extensive public spaces. The most well-known such building was Ivan Nikolaev's communal house built during the first five-year plan in 1929-1930. Here we have a view from above and from the side. So consisted, as you can see, of two parallel units connected by so-called sanitary block. The three-story day use section included a cafeteria, a gym, health center, a solarium, kindergarten, library with a large study area, and multiple rooms for club activities. The eight-story nighttime section contained 1,000 individual 6x6 meter sleeping cubicles organized along narrow corridors. Each cubicle contained two bunks, two stools, and a concrete windowsill that served as a desk. In the mornings, residents would exercise on the balconies of the sanitary block before proceeding to their study areas. And at the end of the day, they would take showers and change into different clothes on their way back to their cells. Now, the disurbanists accused the urbanists of bringing back monasteries, barracks, and student dorms. No one doubted, no one among the architects of the future, as they called themselves, doubted that workers liberated from bourgeois families were entitled to their own separate rooms. But why attach those rooms to endless hallways in inflexible stationary buildings? The only dwellings fit for communism, according to the disurbanists, were individual mobile homes that would be easy to relocate, reassemble, and when appropriate, couple and decouple for mating purposes. As one urban planner explained, each individual would end up behaving like a snail carrying its own shell. And here are a couple of those projects of individual dwellings. This is a more elaborate one. They tended to, virtually all of them, to be on stilts to accommodate an automobile underneath. Now, both the urbanists and disurbanists were, in fact, disurbanists. No one really wished to preserve city streets and blocks. The disagreement was over the location of the individual cells. Both the urbanists and disurbanists were collectivists. Most human activities were to be conducted in public. The question was how many people to assign to each shower room, laundry, or cafeteria. Most important, I think, both urbanists and disurbanists were individualists, insofar as human beings were supposed to live in separate cells, to be recombined at will. Soviet collectivism stood for a direct connection between the individual and the state, or a willingness to see any group of Soviets as a community united by the common goal of building socialism. Bourgeois individualism represented an attempt to surround the individual with an extra protective layer, a desire to see and to belong to a non-transparent community. In other words, Soviet collectivism consisted of individuals. Bourgeois individualism resided in families. And finally, neither the urbanists nor the disurbanists built very much. The party didn't have the money for such things, and the masses didn't seem interested. Most experimental housing built during the first five-year plan was of the so-called transitional type, in which residents were provided with collective services, but allowed for the time being to live in family apartments. The most famous such building was the so-called House of Government, which is to say the house that the Bolshevik leaders built for themselves. It was located on an island in a low-lying, frequently flooded area called the swamp, Bolota. It has that name in Moscow again today. diagonally across the Moskva River from the Kremlin. The largest residential building in Europe, it combined 505 fully furnished family apartments with a vast network of public spaces, including a cafeteria, grocery store, walk-in clinic, childcare center, beauty salon, post office, telegraph, bank, gym, theater, movie theater, laundry, library, tennis court, and several dozen rooms for various activities, from pool playing and target shooting to painting and orchestra rehearsals. So this view is the view from the bridge with the Kremlin behind the photographer. Those of you who have been to Moscow, of course, know this building. It's still there. This is a view from the Cathedral of Christ the Savior, the largest church in the Russian Empire, blown up on Stalin's orders to make way for the ultimate public building of all time, the Palace of Soviets, which was, of course, never built. This is a view from the side street and from the back, and the building with a dome on the left there is the Shock Worker movie theater, the first sound movie theater in the Soviet Union. And this is the facade of the theater. Above the theater, you can see those windows, typical for constructivist architecture. That's where the club was, the tennis courts and various other public spaces. This is a photograph taken from the entrance to the theater with a view of the Kremlin. This is one of the courtyards where children spent most of their time. This is the movie theater cafeteria, the foyer at the entrance to the movie theater, the stairway over there, the library or study area. And then this is the entrance to the club. Most of the spaces are behind the photographer. This is the tennis court, and this is the laundry. In the mid-1930s, the House of Government had about 26 registered tenants. About 700 of them were state and party officials assigned to particular apartments. Most of the rest were their dependents, including about 600 children. Serving the residents and maintaining the building were between 600 and 800 guards, gardeners, waiters, painters, plumbers, janitors, laundresses, floor polishers, and other House of Government employees, including 57 administrators. An island within an island, the House of Government was surrounded by metal gates and armed guards. This is the entryway. On our right was the desk for the guard, uniformed guard. And this is one of the floors. The elevator is on our left. So the building as a whole was an island. It was located on an island. Inside the building, family apartments were islands of privacy protected by those massive doors. And inside each family apartment, the primary cell and inner sanctum, separate from profane family life, was father's study, with the walls covered from floor to ceiling with dark old bookcases and occasionally sabers and rifles, a place of mystery and romance for the house children. I have another one here for you. Here you can see here the portraits of Gorky and Shevchenko, and there's another study. Mothers might or might not have rooms of their own. Children almost always did. Maids slept in little nooks by the entrance to the kitchen, usually behind a curtain. The rest of the rooms were occupied by grown children, elderly parents, and other relatives and dependents. The elderly parents and other relatives and dependents included priests, rabbis, shopkeepers, and illiterate grandmothers. Many of the men and some of the women worried about the bourgeois swarm coming back, but no one seemed to know how to stem the tide. Here's the one of the living rooms from a drawing by a boy who grew up in that building. The lampshades were almost always this way, usually orange, sometimes yellow. And behind the artist, you would have a piano, which was de rigueur. Virtually all the girls and most of the boys had music teachers. So after the assassination of the Leningrad party boss, Sergei Kirov, in December 1934, draining the swamp became the party's number one priority. The so-called Great Terror was a moral panic and a witch hunt, a desperate response to the regeneration of bourgeois domesticity within the house of socialism, and to the inexorable approach of Armageddon, clearly imminent with the rise of Nazi Germany in the West and Japan in the East. The isolation of individuals was both crime and punishment. The root cause of treason was clear. As one of the most prominent Bolsheviks and one-time opposition leader, Grigory Zinoviev, wrote to the Politburo after being accused of masterminding Kirov's assassination. And oops, here he is before his arrest. And there he is at the time he wrote this letter, from which I quote, because we were unable to properly submit to the party, merge with it completely, become imbued with the same feelings of absolute acceptance towards Stalin that the party and the whole country have become imbued with, but instead continue to look backward and to live our separate stifling lives, because of all that, we were doomed to the kind of political dualism that produces double dealing. As accusations mounted, those under suspicion withdrew from the world they were no longer fit to inhabit. Alexei Rykov, Lenin's successor, as chairman of the Council of People's Commissars, here he is before the arrest, and this is after his arrest. And of course, one of the leaders of the right opposition lived in one of the largest apartments in the House of Government. According to his daughter, and I quote from her memoirs, he became withdrawn, stopped talking, ate almost nothing, and paced silently from one corner of the room to the other. Or he lay in bed for hours, thinking just as intensely. He had aged a great deal. His hair had thinned and was always disheveled looking, and his face was haggard with dark bluish circles under his eyes. I don't think he ever slept. He never talked. He just kept thinking and thinking. One day, she continues, I entered the room and was startled by his appearance. He was sitting by the window, his back to it, in a strange, unnatural pose, with his head tilted back, his hands crossed and pressed between his crossed legs, and a tear rolling down his cheek. I don't think he even saw me. He was so engrossed in his thoughts. Rykov's close associate, one-time close friend, and a fellow right oppositionist, Nikolai Bukharin. Here he is. Of course, the party's number one ideologue, stopped leaving his room and refused to bathe. According to his young wife, who was about the same age as Rykov's daughter, and I quote, he became isolated even within the family. He did not want his father to come in and see him suffering. "Go away, Dad," he would say in a weak voice. He grew thin and aged, and his red goatee turned gray. His birds, two African lovebirds, lay dead in their cage. The ivy he planted had wilted. The stuffed birds and pictures on the walls were covered with dust. One of the most prominent Soviet intellectuals, a member of the Supreme Court and the author of The Soviet Family, called Yakov Brandenburgsky, I should say Brandenburgsky, vanished one day from his House of Government apartment. His daughter found him in a mental hospital outside Moscow. According to her memoirs, and again I quote, he seemed totally unaffected by the company of madmen, screaming, squealing, and crawling on the floor beside him. The room was filled with very sick people, but my father seemed perfectly comfortable there. He had even found a friend, a dwarf with a contorted face, whose company he seemed to enjoy. In late 1938, after the Great Terror was over, he suddenly recovered and returned home. He died in 1951 at the age of 70 while playing chess. He never talked about his illness. But most of those who sinned against the party ended up where they started out, in prison. The top ones, including Zinoviev, Rykov, and Bukharin, in solitary confinement. Except at this time, there was no one to tap to or sing along with. They were completely alone, face to face with death and ultimately history. History in the shape of Comrade Stalin, to whom they wrote as a kind of prayer. Bukharin wrote, "If only you possessed an instrument that would allow you to see what was going on inside my poor head. In my heart, I'm with you all, with the party, with my dear comrades." And Zinoviev wrote, "I reached the point where I spend long periods of time looking intently at your portrait and the portraits of the other members of the Politburo in the newspapers with one thought only. My dear ones, please look into my soul. Can it be that you do not see that I'm not your enemy anymore? That I'm yours, body and soul, that I have understood everything, and that I'm ready to do anything to deserve forgiveness and mercy?" There was nothing he or anyone else could do to deserve forgiveness or mercy, although some seemed to believe that they might earn redemption by offering themselves to self-sacrificial participants in scripted show trials. All ended up being shot, one at a time, in the back of the head, at close range. And these are some of those prison photographs of people sentenced to death. And there are, of course, thousands upon thousands of them. The last spasm of the Great Terror was the execution of the executioners. One of the most prominent was Sergei Mironov, the secret police chief of West Siberia and Mongolia, the original proponent of the practice of extrajudicial mass killings, known as Troika killings, and one of the most prolific murderers in Russian history. A title, as you can imagine, not easy to earn. And there he is in his office. In late 1938, he was transferred to the People's Commissariat of Foreign Affairs as head of the Far Eastern Desk. On January the 6th, 1938, he and his wife Agnesa and their daughter went to some friend's place for lunch before taking their children to the circus. And there he is with his beloved wife. Everyone was having a good time, and suddenly the telephone rang. The person at the other end asked for Mironov. Mironov answered the phone, listened with a puzzled look on his face, asked, "But hasn't everything been agreed upon?" And finally said, all right, I'm on my way," and slowly put down the receiver. He told Agnesa that he needed to go down to the commissariat to sign some papers, something to do with the fishing concessions with Japan, but looked thoughtful and anxious. It was a very cold evening. Remember, it was January in Moscow. Agnesa offered him her scarf, and to her amazement, he took it. As she told an interviewer many years later, I quote, "He was silent for a few seconds. Then he looked into my eyes, hugged me, kissed me very, very hard, gently pushed me away, and quickly, without looking back, started running down the stairs. I stood watching as he appeared on one landing, then another, lower and lower. He never once looked back. The door to the outside slammed shut. Everything was still." End quote. 20 minutes later, someone called on the phone and asked for Mironov. Another 20 minutes later, the same person called again. About 2 hours later, the doorbell rang, and the man, whom Agnesa describes as wearing white felt boots, introduced himself as an employee of the Commissariat of Foreign Affairs, apologized for the intrusion, and asked where Mironov was. When the telephone rang again sometime later, it was the Mironov's maid asking Agnesa to come back home to the House of Government. When she did, she found several secret police agents going through their things. The man in the white felt boots demanded her address book and started calling Mironov's relatives. Finally, at about 2 a.m., someone called to say that Mironov had been found and taken into custody. And here is his, one of his last photographs, his official photograph. Now the question that preoccupied Agnesa for the rest of her life was what Mironov had been doing in snowbound Moscow on a dark and very cold January night between 5 p.m. when he left that apartment and 2 a.m. when he arrived in his office at the commissariat. The question we might ask is whether those 9 hours alone in the dark, knee deep in snow, knowing what awaited him, whether those 9 hours are enough of a punishment for what he had done. He spent a year in prison before being sentenced to death, along with 346 other people, most of them secret police officials, but also Bukharin's first wife, Nadezhda Lukina, an immobile invalid, the writer Isaac Babel, and the theater director, Sevolod Nirhult. But to conclude, the longest and most tragic and bewildering Bolshevik loneliness, I think, was that of the martyred Bolsheviks' wives. This is a portrait of one of them done by another one that just returned from exile. Most of the men were executed within weeks or months of the arrest, although their children wouldn't be informed for over 2 decades. Most of the women were sent to special camps for family members of traitors to the motherland, where they spent 8 years plus another 10 or so in exile before returning to their children's new homes. Old, sick, unwanted, unloved, and utterly lost. The party and the socialist states which they had helped build were still there, but the faith was gone along with their husbands. They and their children had nothing to say to each other. Most memorists describe that time and those relationships as silences, coexisting silences, forms of isolation, if you will. After Stalin's death, the wife of the first president of the Soviet State Bank and chairman of the Supreme Council of the National Economy, Valeria Nasinsky, Yekaterina, returned from exile and moved in with her daughter. As her daughter Svetlana writes in her memoirs, thus began our 3 years of torment, which are not worth describing because they're so easy to imagine. Until the very end, she would sit completely straight in a simple 10-ruble lawn chair, which I would push around the apartment. Her main occupation was reading, but only books she had read before. Sometimes, when looking at my mother from behind, I would notice her back begin to quiver and shake. She would suddenly burst into violent sobs while reading something that brought back memories, or more often while listening to music. When the sweet strains of Lakmé's aria, "Where Will the Young Indian Girl, a Pariah, Go," poured forth from the radio, mother, no matter how hard she tried, could not hold back the sobs, which would then turn into almost a howl. And I would like to leave you with those sweet strains. Thank you very much.